I want to encourage you. Listen, lock in to the purposes of God. And destiny has such a tremendous deposit of vision and blessing. And this missions conference that we've enjoyed this last week, it's just been so outstanding, and I just thank God for it. And I want to encourage you this morning to just to continue to move forward and expand. I think before I minister, I need to have my wife stand. You know, I can't believe it. Jeannie and I, this year, will celebrate 50 years of marriage. Good night, girl. Stand up. My lands, I don't even feel 50. I don't know if you heard about the guy that he and his wife were celebrating a 50-year anniversary, and so they drove to California, and he was walking along the beach and stumbled over a bottle and picked it up, and a genie popped out. And the genie said, okay, you get one wish. Oh, he said, man, he said, my wife and I are celebrating 50-year anniversary. He said, we've always wanted to go to Hawaii, but I'm too scared to fly. And she gets seasick just looking at the water. He said, my one wish is that you would build a bridge from California all the way to Hawaii. And Jeannie started laughing and said, are you crazy? Do you realize how far it is to go across the Pacific Ocean? And how far down we'd have to... do you understand the logistics of planting supports to be able to handle a bridge? Yeah, forget that. Come up with another wish. Well, he stood there for a moment thinking about that thing. And he said, for 50 years, he said, my wife has told me that I'm insensitive and that I just don't understand her. He said... after 50 years to be able to understand women and specifically to be able to understand my wife. The genie looked at him for a minute and said, do you want that bridge two lane or four lanes? Thank you, John. Now, don't look at your wife. Just look right here, guys. I love you, Jeannie. You know, a couple of weeks ago as we started this new year, and let me get right into what I want to share with you. I was in prayer, and the Holy Spirit impressed me that the greatest need for my life and ministry for this year was to stay filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Now listen, I've been filled with the Holy Ghost for over 50 years, and I thought, that's a strange thing. And then the Lord impressed me even farther and said, the greatest need for IBC, for this church, is that every person is filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, I shared that a couple of weeks ago, and we were praying for people all over the place. I don't believe that's just what God wants for IBC. I believe that God's heart and God's desire is that every person in this house of worship is filled to an overflowing with the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you something. If you're going to live the abundant life, if you're going to have the fire of the Spirit, and be able to live the victorious Christian life that God wants you to live, you're going to have to be filled to an overflowing of the Spirit of the Lord. See, we're living in days that pressures are coming to bear upon our families, our marriages, our lives, that anything less than an almighty touch from God's Spirit and God's power, we're not going to be adequate and we're not going to be able to live as God wants us to live. And I think one of the great concerns that I have in my heart, especially in ministry, is that we're raising a generation of Christians who have never really had a God encounter. I don't mean that they're not believers, but they've never experienced a vibrant, undeniable manifestation of the power of the Holy Spirit upon their life. They trust Christ, they know the Lord intellectually, and they believe the Bible. but they've never had a Mount Carmel, a day of Pentecost, a burning bush experience where their life is literally consumed by the power of the presence of God. They've never truly been baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. Everybody said fire. You know, just a couple of years ago, I was in prayer. In fact, I meet the Lord in prayer each morning from 7 to 8. And generally, a couple of the guys will meet me at the IBC chapel. And during that week, I'd had one of the ladies call me from the church and said, I've got a friend whose brother was in an accident. And he was jettisoned out of the car and exploded his lungs. She said, would you go to the hospital? She said, I believe that his sister Veronica said that he's at University Hospital. And I said, Araceli, what's his name? She said, I don't even know his name. I'll try to find out for you. And when I hung up, I said, oh, brother, I don't even know who this guy is. Don't even know exactly what room. Thinks that he's at University Hospital, and I sort of discounted it. And she called back and said, he's on the 8th floor, University Hospital. His name is Isaac. She gave me the particulars. And I just got tied up over the weekend. And on Sunday, she came up to me. She said, Pastor, she said, have you gone to the... Oh, I said, oh, Araceli, I am so sorry. I forgot. I'll tell you what. I'll make sure that I do that this week. She said, you've got to go tomorrow. I said, okay. So as I was in prayer the next morning, I remembered that I'd committed myself to go to prayer, and I, just to be honest with you, I wasn't really overly excited about it. She didn't know the family. She really didn't know this guy, didn't know much about the situation. I got in the pickup and started driving over toward the medical center. I had the radio on, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me. Two things: turn the radio off and pray in the Spirit. I thought, that is just my mind, but I felt impressed. So I pushed the radio off, and I started praying, and then praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit. Immediately, I said, I'm on a God mission today. I sensed a certain presence of the Lord. I knew this is more than just a little hospital visit. So I prayed in tongues. I prayed in the Spirit all the way across. And you remember a couple of years ago, you had to park. It took you 20 minutes from the time you parked at University Hospital to even get into the hospital. But the entire time, either praying out loud in the pickup or under my breath while I was going up to the room, praying in the Spirit. And when I walked into that room, found where he was, under a ventilator, his lungs had been totally... In fact, what had happened, he had hit one of these barriers, these concrete dividers here in the city, and his girlfriend was in the car as well. He's 18 years of age, and Isaac had hit that thing, and it had jettisoned him out of the car. I thought he went through the windshield 80 feet. He actually went out the driver's window 80 feet down the highway and exploded his lungs. He was under a ventilator. I walked into the room. His mother was there. She was Spanish and speaking. She really didn't understand my English, but she did understand prayer. And while I'm standing there praying for this young man who is unconscious and under the ventilator, his sister Veronica came in the room and began to pray with me. I remember the faith and the prayer of commanding his lungs to come alive in the name of Jesus. He came out of his unconsciousness, held both of his thumbs up, still under the ventilator. His sister turned to me and said, she said, last night they did emergency surgery. They went in. They were extracting bones and fragments all through his lungs. And they finally sewed him up because they knew that if they kept him any longer, that it perhaps could damage his brain. They sewed him up, and she said, they told the family, they told us, they've done everything they can do. They didn't give us any hope. But he woke up and both thumbs up. I said, Veronica, believe the word of the Lord. Your brother is going to be healed. The next morning, I went up to University Hospital to the 8th floor and went into that intensive care unit. They had him in a separate bed, and I was standing there when, for the first time, he took his first breath without a ventilator. And for the next several weeks, he was gaining strength and being able to breathe on his own. Then they put him out for therapy. I was there the day that he walked out of the hospital. God healed that young man. But I went back, and you know, to be honest with you, see, my faith was not there. I really was. In fact, I was less than enthusiastic about going and praying for him. I really had not connected. But the Spirit of God had something different in the Holy Spirit's mind for the life of this boy. And I'm telling you something, if we're not filled with the power of the Holy Ghost and able to connect with the spirit of what God is wanting to say, we're not going to be able to accomplish what God wants to accomplish through our lives and in our lives. How many of you know, people, all of us need to be encouraged today to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And every one of us need to seek fresh fillings of God's presence and God's Spirit, because there's so many things that will dampen and pour water upon the spirit of life of God's fire in your heart. And we need to keep our hearts burning brightly for the Lord. It's to this point, the text. In 2 Timothy, the Apostle Paul, facing martyrdom, it's within a year of his own death, he pens this letter of 2 Timothy to his son in the faith. This is Paul's final epistle. In writing to Timothy, he's concerned that this young man fan the fire, that he keep the fire of God's Spirit alive in his heart. And we have his Paul's final instructions. Look at them with me. 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning in verse 2. To Timothy, a beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father in Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded in you also. Now look at verse 6. Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. Look at verse 14 of this chapter. He says, guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives within us. Woo, can you say amen to that? Let me read verse 6 to you again. It's really the text of the day. Therefore, I remind you to stir up. Everybody say stir up. In fact, the NIV, I want to read the New International. It actually says fan the flame. And that's my message, fan the fire. But in verse 6, he says, I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. The NIV says, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Woo, hallelujah. Hey, look at your neighbor and say, fan the fire. Amen. Fan the fire. You know, in 15 years of Paul's missionary ministry, he had covered the 3 missionary journeys and had touched the 5 provinces. Every major city on the eastern side of the Roman Empire had been touched by the ministry of Paul. He had traveled, scholars have documented, over 20,000 miles by land and sea. And Timothy had been saved under Paul's first missionary journey, and then had joined on the second missionary journey and became one of Paul's spiritual sons. In 1 Timothy, Paul pins the letter to this young man, Timothy, who is taking the pastoralship of the church at Ephesus, and he knows that this young man can get discouraged, and if there's anything that Timothy needs, Paul knows that it's the power of the Holy Spirit. And so Paul writes to him in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 14, he said, "Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership." Don't forget the gift. Don't hold to the gift of what God has deposited in your life. In 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 20 of that same book, "O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge." I think in today's language, Paul is saying, hey, don't get caught up in all the foolish issues that everybody wants to get caught up in. Don't chase after nonsensical tangents that don't amount to a hill of beans. Stay with what's real and what's vibrant and what will transform your life and the world around you. Wow. Now, I mentioned to you that Paul's facing martyrdom. He's in prison. In fact, he's in the prison that was known in Rome as the Mamertine Prison. It was a subterranean structure. Originally, it had served as a cistern in Rome. And then when converted in a prison for men that were actually had a death sentence upon them, they would be lowered into this rat-infested, stinking mud hole. And so Paul knows that his death is near. In fact, he pins in chapter 4 of 2 Timothy, you might want to look at these couple of verses, it's in verse 6, he said, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but all those who love his appearing." So Paul knows his voice will soon be silenced. He can hear the axe grinding. The deranged Nero, who is now the emperor, in 64 AD, just 2.5 years before this, he had burned Rome. Actually, over half of Rome was burned to the ground. It so infuriated and angered the Romans, and they wouldn't stop their anger. Finally, and it's believed that Nero did it himself, needing a scapegoat, he blamed the already despised Christian community, and it became open season on Christian believers. Christians were rounded up by the thousands. Many of them were sewn into the skins of animals and then thrown to the ravages of the wild dogs as they ripped at those animal skins. Other believers were baptized in tar and used as flaming torches to illuminate the night and the drunken chariot races of Nero himself. Wow. Some were crucified, nailed to crosses. So Paul writes to Timothy. It's in this final letter, and he says, now listen, Timothy. He knows that Timothy needs to be encouraged. He needs to stay right on front. He needs to understand the purposes of God in his life. And so he says to him in verse 6, he said, now I'm putting you in remembrance. You stir up the gift. You make sure that you stay right on target. You stir up the gift that God has put in your hands. Fan the fire, Timothy. Make sure you do not allow the fire to dim and die. Keep the fire burning. Rekindle the flame of the fire that's within your heart. Wow. See, the fire evidently had begun to flicker and dim and die. And so there's six ways I want to identify them for you. In fact, I want you to jot them down. I'm going to give them to you right quick. They all begin with the letter R. Real simple. Some of these Paul talks to Timothy about. Here's how you fan the fire and rekindle the flame and keep it burning sharply so that the power of the Holy Spirit is quick and sharp in your life. And so grab your pen. Here's six ways that we keep the fan. How many of you know that if we allow the circumstances of life, discouragements and depression, and you get your eyes on politics, and there's so many things that will dampen your spirit and kill the life of God in your heart. We're literally bombarded from every side and every dimension. I'm telling you, I believe that the enemy wants to do anything and everything he can to somehow try to quill and dampen and put the fire of the Holy Spirit out in our lives. And it's up to us to make sure that we keep the fire burning. I really believe that the devil, when you walk out of your house in the morning, ought to be standing there with a walkie-talkie and say, "There he comes. Look out." You know, Brother John Bell used to have a saying, and some of you heard him say that. He told me that one time when I had him pray for me. I was preparing to speak to several hundred ministers, and he said, "David, when you got the living water on the inside and you got the fire on the outside," he said, "you can't help but overflow." How many of you know that's a great word? Oh, when you got the living water on the inside and you got the fire on the outside, you can't help but overflow. So the question is, how do we keep the fire burning bright? How do we fan the flame? Here it is. First one, repent. Man, I know I started out with a heavy, didn't I? Hey, repent is not some heavy word. It just means to turn around and repent. Get before the Lord and just open your spirit right now. I'm confident the Holy Spirit, because I heard the voice of the Holy Spirit to share this word with you. And so I know right now he's sitting on your, he's right inside your heart. And he's going to bring to your mind, he's going to speak to your conscience. I'm not here to beat you over the head. But he's going to tell you right now things that you've allowed, activities in your life, things that dampen the spirit, things that quill the life and the fire of God. And he's going to tell you, maybe it's not just an activity, it may be an attitude. Maybe you picked up some negative, critical spirit. Maybe it's some gossiping attitude. Maybe it's just some sort of negative. Hey, repent. When the Holy Spirit puts his finger on that, just surrender. See, to repent is to surrender to the voice of the Spirit. Don't justify, rationalize. No. It's submit to it and say, "Okay, Lord." And along with that, we need to repent. If everything that we know God wants us to be and maybe what we used to be, we're not, that's an indication that the fire is not burning as it should. And so we just simply need to say, "Lord, I repent. I repent of this. Remove this from my heart. Take this from my life. Lord, I just surrender to you." Can I get a big amen? So the first thing that we need to do is we need to repent. Second, we need to review. Review. That simply means we need to go back in our mind to when the fire was burning brightest and hottest. Take inventory. Review. What was going on in your life? What about the devotion in your life? What about the burden, the passion, the vision that you had for the kingdom of God? Your hunger for spiritual things. Whew. It wasn't your job. It wasn't just sports. There was something that was burning on the inside. You just kicking your ribs. And review. Take a moment. What was going on in your life? And so I need to recapture. That's another good R, but that's not one of the words. But I need to review. I need to recapture what was going on in my life. My prayer time. My devotional time. The fire of God. And then thirdly, I need to refocus. Refocus. Refocus your attention upon the Lord. You've allowed other things to somehow eclipse your one single purpose of serving the Lord and walking with Him. I'll never forget several years ago here on 410 taking the Callahan exit and pulling off, and somebody had on a bumper sticker said, "Keeping the main thing is the main thing." I turned to Jeannie, I said, "Have you ever heard such double talk in all your life? Keeping the main thing is the main thing. Keeping the main thing," I said, for heaven's sakes, I said, "people want to put stuff like that on their bumper and just talking." Pulled away from the light and the knock on wood, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, "What is the main thing?" How many of you know that for the child of God, the main thing is your relationship with Him? The main thing is He is Lord of every area of our life. Keeping the main thing is the main thing. Woo, can I get a witness? Hey, look at your neighbor and say, "Keep the main thing." Hallelujah. Amen. Keep the main. So we need to repent. We need to review. Then we need to refocus. I need to make sure that what is before my eyes. Incidentally, a passage of Scripture, Hebrews chapter 12, those first three verses. "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses," that's the heroes of faith, "let's make sure that we lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us, and that we run the race," wow, "that is set before us. Looking," here it is, people, if you're going to run the race, "looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls." Are you discouraged today? Are you kind of, hey, get your, refocus. Come on, get your eyes off of everybody else. I'll tell you what. I watched a little bit of Fox News last night of all the nonsense going on in Washington, D.C., and I'm telling you what, I thought, those bunch of idiots. I mean, those. They don't know it, but God's got his hand on America. Repent. Review, refocus, and then, oh, this is very important. Number four, reject the lies. Reject. This is the first real negative one. Reject the lies of Satan. Now, reject the lies. You know what the lies of Satan are? Hey, he comes along and he says, "Look, you're discouraged. You're tired. You kind of need to back off. You don't get so intense about this thing. You could serve the Lord. And besides that, you're too old. Let younger people do it. Or you're too young. Let the older people carry it on." He's always wanting to slip up, whisper in your ear, dampen the fire, get you to back off. People don't appreciate you anyhow. Why in the world should you be so concerned and care? Why should you be? Hey, tell the devil he's a liar. Fan the fire. Make sure that the fire is burning brightly in your heart. In fact, I love the passage, Psalms 92 and verse 10. "But you have made me as strong as a wild ox. You have anointed me," whoo, "with the finest of oil." How many of you claim God's anointing oil today? Oh, yeah, God's anointing oil. The New King James says of this passage, "But my horn," that speaks of my head, "you have exalted like a wild ox. I have been anointed with fresh oil." Oh, hallelujah. Everybody slip your hands up to the Lord and say, "Fresh oil." Fresh oil. Not last year's oil.
Not yesterday's oil. Fresh oil that's going to fall upon our hearts on a daily basis. Fresh oil of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory to God. Hey, y'all remember the children's doggerel? It talks about the two frogs that fell into the can. Two frogs fell into a can of cream, or so it has been told. The sides of the can were shiny and steep, and the cream was deep and cold. Oh, it's no use, said number one. It's no use. We might as well just give up. It's fate. There's no help around. So goodbye, my friend. Goodbye, sad world. And weeping still, he drowned. But number two of sterner stuff, dog paddled in surprise, that while he licked his creamy lips and blinked his creamy eyes, he said, I'll swim for just a while, he said. Or he thought, or so it has been said, he said, it's not going to help the world if another frog were dead. So he, for an hour or two, he kicked and swam. Not once did he stop to mutter. And then he hopped out by an island. He had made a fresh churned butter. Hey, you're just going to keep kicking. I'm going to be anointed with fresh oil. God's spirit and God's fire is going to fall upon my life. Woo, hallelujah. You repent. You review. You refocus. And then you reject the lies of the devil. And then number five, I couldn't come with just one, so I had these two. Retreat and renew. That is, you renew your fellowship with him. You sort of pull back and determine. Take some time to be alone with the Lord. Oh, I tell you what, I do it every day. I'm telling you, people, if you'll just retreat and renew, he's waiting there all the time. He wants that relationship, and it's keeping the main thing, which is the main thing. You remember about 25 years ago? You know, I'm still singing choruses from 25 and 30 years ago. I love the choruses that we sang today. I thought the worship this morning was so beautiful. And I love the words of that one song, there's a miracle right now. Why? Because the Spirit of God is here. I thought, wow, are we paying attention to the words that we're singing? Because when the Spirit of God is present, miracles begin to happen. Things begin to take place. God resurrects your brain. You go to the hospital when you're not even thinking about wanting to go to the hospital. And you go and lay hands on a man and command life to come into his dead lungs. And he walks out because the power of the Holy Ghost is a miracle-working power. Woo! Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You remember the chorus, and this fits with renew and retreat. We used to sing, shut in with God in a secret place. There in the Spirit, beholding his face. Remember that? Gaining new power to run in this race. You know, I should have told you all that I've got a new chorus to teach you this morning. I long to be shut in with God. Oh, hallelujah. You renew and retreat, seeking the face of the Lord, allowing him to cleanse you and renew you, refire you, because we can get distracted by so many things, cluttered down with the things of life. Well, I'll never forget. In fact, it might have been right here at Destiny 30 years ago, either that or at IBC, when Larry Lee from Dallas was here and he spoke here at Destiny. In fact, it was, I believe, at a missions conference, and then spoke at IBC. And Larry Lee told us about a recent experience that he had of having Dr. Cho. At that time, he had 500,000 people in his church. Today, it's closer to 1 million. And what brought this back to my mind was this last Tuesday night, Tuesday night, Brother Mike Ware ministered here at the missions conference, and
He was talking to me and telling me about being in Seoul, Korea, with he and Larry Stockstill and Dr. Cho and that incredible ministry. Do you know what he told me? Mike Ware said the other day, he said he doesn't even allow cell leaders to become leaders of the cell group until they fast for 40 days. I said, you're kidding. Mike said, no. I thought, dear Lord, have mercy. That'd disqualify a whole lot of us. But Larry Lee said, Dr. Cho flew into Dallas. He was going to speak in the church there. And he got a phone call from Dr. Criswell, who pastored the big First Baptist Church in Dallas and founded the seminary, the Criswell College and Seminary there in Dallas. And Dr. Criswell said, Larry, he said, can I take you and Dr. Cho to lunch? He said, yeah, that sounds great. He said, Dr. Criswell came over with his limousine, and Dr. Cho and Larry Lee got into the back of the vehicle, and he said, we were facing each other. And he said, we didn't even hardly have greetings of hello, how are you? When out of the mouth of Dr. Criswell, he looked at Cho, this humble little Korean Asian pastor, and he said, how do you do it? How do you do it? How do you pastor 500,000 people? Larry said he looked at Dr. Cho. He had that cute Korean grin. He said, it's real easy. He said, every day I get up and pray. And then I just go, obey. It really is that simple. It really is that simple. And that comes out of the fire of the Holy Spirit that's burning. Retreat and renew. And then let me close by saying, number six, be refilled. Open your life to fresh fire of the Holy Spirit, fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. The Apostle Paul said, don't be drunk with wine where is in excess, but be filled. Actually, the Greek rendering of that passage is be being filled with the Spirit. It speaks about a constant, ongoing filling of the Spirit. Did you know that in Acts 2, it says that all the believers that were in the upper room were filled with the Holy Ghost? And then in Acts 4, it says, and the Holy Ghost fell. All of those believers that were gathered together, some of the same people in Acts 2 were in Acts 4. That says something very clear about all of our vessels. You leak. Yes, they were filled in chapter 2, but they needed filled again in chapter 4. All of us need to constantly fan the fire, fan the flame, be filled afresh with the power of the Holy Spirit. Can you say amen? Let me close by telling you, you know, we want to accomplish everything that God has for us accomplished before He calls us to glory. The great passion and desire in my heart is that I want to impart before I depart. I've discovered that I can't spread fire if I don't have a little bit of it in my own life. Hello? And God wants to fill every one of us with the fire of the Holy Spirit, and that we fan the flame. Oh, I claim that for your life today. Everybody stand to your feet with me, would you? That we fan the fire, we fan the flame. Maurice, can we go back to those six R's? Let's see if we can get those up there on the PowerPoint. All six of those R's Repent. Everybody repeat. Repent. Review. Refocus. Reject Satan's lies. Retreat and renew. And refill.